So, as Anselma said, my name is John van Brugge, and this is Brian Jensen from Eurofins.
Hi.
I work for Avery Dennison as a product regulatory compliance specialist. My main focus on my day-to-day job is on food and pharma. And let me tell you a little bit about how this seminar came to where we are today. So, as we are a label store company, we do a lot of different types of applications on food, on pharma applications, but within those particular segments, there are also in-depth requirements. And we are looking outwards to test institutes that give her their third-party opinion on the testing that we need to do on our products. Eventually, we ended up with Eurofins, quite positive remarks there. And we asked them to be here at Labelexpo and do a joint presentation on food compliance, particularly on making this complex topic much more simpler, because it does not have to be that difficult. So for me, and I think for Avery Dennison as well, the partnership with Eurofins is very fruitful already. We're doing more and more stuff together, and we're gaining more knowledge on the products and particularly on the food contact application side. So with that, I hand over to Brian. I think we all have a nice presentation, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank Brian, you.
Floor is yours.
Thank you, John. Can you all hear me as well? Great. So my name is Brian Jensen, and I'm situated in Denmark with Eurofins product testing. And first of all, I would like to thank Avery Dennison for this opportunity today to come here and present this topic, where we try to take the simple approach to food contact material testing and compliance proving. First, a bit of a mandatory slide about Eurofins. If you don't know Eurofins, we are an independent third-party testing laboratory founded in 1987. We are now at 800 laboratories across 47 countries with more than 45,000 employees. Eurofins is divided into these four divisions, where we have food testing, environment testing, pharmaceutical testing, and consumer products. And I'm located in the consumer product sets division, where we do the food contact material consultancy and testing. So why do we need to focus on food contact material at all? In the past, we have had some stories in the newspapers where companies are put out there in the open to the consumers. We had this with the contaminated chocolate bunnies in the Netherlands, and recently we also in Denmark have the ban on polyfluorinated substances. But we also had the photo initiators in printing inks in the past. We have been discussing mineral oils a lot. Phthalates and bisphenol A has been discussed intensively over the last many years. And NIAS is an increasing discussion currently. So, yeah. And my colleague Mette made this slide in her kitchen once, just to show that a regular consumer creating some Christmas cookies and show that just by doing this in your own kitchen, how many different kind of food contact materials do you actually come into contact with when you work with that? You see, you have all these products that she makes together, but already before this, you have all the production facilities as well, where you have some kind of contact with the food. You have the bowl, you have the kitchen table or a wooden board, you have the baking paper, and then some kind of reuse tray for storing the finished cookies. And really, the consumer shouldn't worry about if this is safe or not. It just has to be safe. And this is why we need to focus on compliance on our food contact materials. Regulation-wise, we have from the top the framework regulation 1935-2004, valid for all food contact materials. I'll just skip one slide ahead and then go back to this, because we have the framework regulation over here. It basically states that the food contact material should not endanger human health. It should not make an unacceptable change in the composition of the food that could be colors and such. And it should not deteriorate the organoleptic properties of the food. And that's basically what's stated in the framework regulation. And no one can disagree that this is needed for all food contact materials. But the framework regulation doesn't help the industry how to comply with this. It just states that this is what you need to do, but we need to figure out how to do it. Then we have the GMP regulation stating all these things with traceability and having a nice production and such. And then we have the blue ones down below, where you have the material specific regulations. Plastics is probably the most well-known. And then you have the green materials, where you don't have any specific regulations for those materials. They still have to comply with 1935-2004, but we don't have any specific regulation telling us how to comply with this. So for these materials, we have to rely on best practice guidelines, industry guidelines, national guidelines, and such. And this is where we need to be careful with how we set up the test plans and such. Besides the framework regulation, when we talk labels, as this expo is about, you need to consider that the plastics regulation has an article, Article 14, about multi-material, multi-layer materials and articles, where it's stated that each plastic layer in such an article shall comply with regulation 10/2011. However, plastic layers not in direct contact with the food or behind a functional barrier should not comply with the positive list. So for these layers, you can have substances in there that are not in the positive list in the plastic regulation. However, these substances may not be CMR substances, so they cannot be mutagens, and they cannot be harmful in any way. In the same way, overall and specific migration limits do not apply to the individual plastic layers. However, you will see that in most cases, they will apply to the finished product, either by national law or client standards. So typically, you would test the finished products of a multilayer for overall migration and specific migration in a way to comply with the framework regulation. So what you want to do before you do anything else, when you have a label, you want to consider how is this label even used? What product is it to be used for? Is it to be used directly on the food? On a plastic container, PE or PET, or a glass bottle? It's quite clear that if you use it on the glass bottle, you don't have to think much about it, because the glass will be a quite good barrier for all the substances. But if you put it directly on the food, you need to be much more careful what kind of composition you have in your label. At the same time, you can consider how the label is built up. Is there a functional barrier within the label as well, where we can make it easier for ourselves in respect to how to put the test plan together? Doing so, however, we should always consider the possible set-off if we stack the labels or roll the labels, where the outside can set off to the inside of the next label. The way to deal with all these compliance rules is to use a DOC, a Declaration of Compliance. And to show what this is, it's basically your responsibility is to get info from your suppliers, collect the data, raw material info, test reports if they have those, DOCs, toxicological info, and then you have to figure out what's relevant, what's required, and what can you guarantee your client. And then you put that into your own declaration of compliance. And this is what your client needs to see. How can this product be used? What are the limitations? And so on. So why do we need a declaration of compliance? We need it to ensure that the end user use the product as it is intended. All these are examples where we have seen that it goes wrong. I'm sure that if you take the Budweiser cans, that there's the marketing division at Budweiser at first thought this was great, a great idea, but I'm quite sure the quality manager would be afraid that this would be an issue, because of course they didn't test the bottles for direct food contact on the outside. So yeah, it's just to show that you need to clearly emphasize how your products can be used in the end. This is another example. If the ice cube trays, all of a sudden all the baby magazines tell to put baby food in those as well, but if they are only tested for water, this could be a bad thing as well. So to make this easy for everyone, there needs to be a flow of information in the chain of business operators. If we have the chemical producers out far to the right and we have the packaging producers far to the left, we would have an increasingly knowledge of the material in the product that way towards the chemical producers, but also a decreasing responsibility for the final food. So for the packaging producer to be able to comply with all these things, they rely on getting the information from the suppliers behind themselves. So it's important that you have a declaration of compliance in each step to be able to fully comply with the regulation in the end. So when you're ready to start looking at your test plan, again, make it simple. Testing can be expensive, we know that. So why not start considering grouping products? Often people think that they have to test all their products, but you can be smart about it and try to group products where it makes sense to cut down on the testing costs and still be in compliance with the regulation. Always consider the type of food and the choice of food simulants when you set up the test plan. If you only use it for clear drinks, for instance, there's no need to also test it for fatty foodstuff. So be smart about how you set up the test plan and look into what you actually offered from the laboratory on that. Storage time and temperature is important as well. Typically, this is not something influencing the testing course, but if you test it too excessive, you might fail the test and then you will have to test again. So it's important to consider these things carefully before you set the test in motion. And of course, you need to consider if there's any substances in the material that has specific restrictions, and can any of these restrictions be calculated? You are allowed to do calculations and show compliance with this. You don't have to do the testing. Often it's not possible to calculate because you don't have all the info, but if you have a nice supplier telling you we added exactly this amount of this substance, you might be able to calculate that even if all the substance migrate out into the food, we are still below the limit value and then we don't need to test it. So again, this is a way to cut down on expenses. And finally, before we start the test, it's important to just consider can the product actually physically withstand the test conditions that we have set up. If the plastic will melt at these conditions, we would like to test it, then it's not a good idea to go that way. So always consider that. And then in the final step, consider if it makes sense to bring in a consultant to help with the test plan. Our experience is that often it can be difficult to get these informations from the suppliers about even the identity of the substance. Much more difficult is it to get the content. So maybe involving a consultant, it's easier to have the test plan created. And maybe it's even an advantage towards your clients, telling them that, yeah, but we didn't do this ourselves. We actually brought in a consultant to help us on this. So this is what they told us to do. So it can be used in a way of marketing perspective. This is just an example of a multi-layer material where we put together all the substances in the product. And as you see, there are quite some products here. Luckily, the foil supplier here already tested those substances. So we can help this client, okay, we can use that documentation again, so we don't have to test for these again. And then we have an ink supplier with a lot of substances. We could consider contacting that ink supplier and ask them, can you supply a different ink with less substances that could fit the same purpose for us? And then again, cut down on expensive. And then you can, of course, again, do groupings. So if you have a product range and you have some of the same raw materials in it, you can discuss if you need to test everything or not. Testing-wise, we have the overall migration that most people know by now. It's a hygienic parameter where we just want to check that the food contact material doesn't release plastic material or whatever material into our food. We do this according to the standard called 1186 from 2002. They're actually amending that right now, but we don't know when the new version will be coming, but there will be a new version. An immersion cell pouch and filling is the different techniques you can use. And here you need to consider if it's a single-sided exposure, or you can do the immersion testing with a double-sided exposure. For labels and multi-materials, you would often choose the cell exposure. For the aqueous food simulants, overall migration is basically an evaporation residue. And for the oil migration, it's a weight loss of the sample because you cannot do an evaporation of the oil. Specific migration is a bit more important. It's the toxicological parameter. So this is really the safety of the consumer. We test according to 13130 from 2004. And we always recommend using worst case food simulants, because if you test in all food simulants at all times, it gets very expensive. So again, be smart about it. If you know that 3% acetic acid will be worst case, then let's do the test on that. And if you are compliant with that, everything is fine. We are allowed to use replacement simulants in the cases where we cannot test in the real simulant. Could be olive oil, for instance, where you cannot reach a detection limit low enough to comply with the limit value, then you can switch to a replacement simulant. And the testing is, uses different techniques, GCMS, LCMS, and so on. And we always quantify against a calibration curve, where we actually have the chemical we are looking for as a reference. So it's a target test. So that was basically what I was going to say today. As a summary, stepwise, be aware that we have the framework regulation. It is in compliance for all food it is valid for all food contact material. And we are dependent on this flow of information from our suppliers to make this happen. Gain knowledge, collect the data, and consider the actual use of the product. Assess the data you collect, perform risk assessments where it makes sense, group products, carry out the necessary testing, and then combine all the data in your declaration of compliance, and then clearly communicate with your clients or customers about the intended use of the product. And this statement from below is something John came up with, and it's actually quite good. Simplify this process by working with the right partner. So also for your suppliers as well, if your suppliers are not willing to help you be in compliance, maybe you should search for a supplier that actually do something in this and wants to help you with this compliance work. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, John. I will now open it for the questions, if there are any from the audience. Questions? No?
I have a question.
Everything was clear then.
Yeah, yeah.
Go ahead, John.
So, just to get it straight, you mentioned the overall migration testing and the specific migration testing. Do you have to always use them both, or especially from a label stock or a printer perspective, converter perspective, it might be more interesting to do the specific migration rather than the overall migration?
Yeah, it depends on the material. If it's a plastic material, you have to do both. If it's a paper material, it's not necessarily a requirement to do overall migration, then specific migration will be the way to go. But for plastic material, it's stated directly in the legislation that you have to do both.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.